The woman accusing President Trump's Supreme Court nominee of physical and sexual assault may indeed testify next week. But an attorney for Christine Blasey Ford says it will not be Monday, the day the Senate Judiciary Committee had scheduled for a hearing, and Judge Brett Kavanaugh, the president's nominee, is set to be there. However, there are so many other details that are out being negotiated right now, sort of reopens the door to those conversations between Capitol Hill and Professor Ford. Also breaking right now, the senator overseeing this hearing, the judiciary chair, Chuck Grassley, is now dealing with protests and arrests happening outside of his office. So let's go up to Capitol Hill and CNN congressional correspondent Sunlin Sarfati. And Sunlin, let's just start on the breaking news, because I've got this letter from Ford's attorney to Capitol Hill saying she wishes to testify as long as they guarantee her safety.
That's right. This is a significant development, and a significant development, I should add, the fact that they are continuing to communicate, the attorneys for Ford and the chairman of the committee. Now, this is a letter that was sent from Dr. Ford's attorney to the Senate Judiciary Chairman, saying that she is prepared to potentially testify next week. As you note, though, they said Monday will not work for them, essentially, but they say she wishes to testify, provided that we can agree on terms that are fair and which ensure her safety. They also go on in this letter, notably, Brooke, to again say that their strong preference would be to have an FBI investigation first, but they did not stipulate that that was required for her to testify, and that's an important point here. So the big question, of course, is what, of course, are those fair terms that they outlined? And that really is important, because that's where the devil is in the details now, and where, honestly, this could either come together or fail and fall apart again. And we've seen them over the last 48 hours through attorneys and through aides really grappling with what are those fair terms? Will there be outside witnesses? Where will this happen? Will this happen on Capitol Hill? Will this potentially happen out in California where she lives? So a lot of details still need to be worked out. It certainly increases the pressure now on Chairman Grassley's staff to respond. He has really made pains to show that he is trying to pull her in and trying to have her testify. And he's said, I've laid out four options in private, in public, out in California, here on Capitol Hill. So I think the ball now is in his court and his team's court to figure out what is fair. Of course, this will likely go through many more iterations before it potentially gets settled. But again, that she is potentially prepared to testify next week. She does not want Monday to happen. We'll see if there's wiggle room from the chairman to potentially move this testimony.
Sunlin, thank you so much for the reporting. Let's have a broader conversation and analysis. Dana Bash is up with us. She covered Capitol Hill for years and years. I can imagine she knows what may be happening behind the scenes. She's our chief political correspondent. Ron Clay knows as well. He was chief counsel for the Senate Judiciary Committee. So great to have both of you on as this news is breaking. Dana, just starting with you, listen, we're all getting this at the same time, and we're trying to parse mm-hmm. together what this may mean, right? This may mean a yes on her part if mm-hmm. her safety is insured. You know, her address is blasted out there. She's been receiving death threats. We know she's called for this FBI investigation. Does it sound to you like they're willing to perhaps put that aside?
You mean the
investigation?
Ford?
Yes,
oh,
yes.
Yes, it does. Of course
yes.
it does. I mean,
yes.
I read it exactly that way. This to me looks like somebody who is saying, please get me to yes, I want to do this. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe one is the wrong way to say it, because clearly this yeah. is this, if it happens, is going to be about the most traumatic thing since this ever happened to her. But this is written in a way to tell the Judiciary Committee, we're going to do this, we want to do this, please help us get to yes. There's no question. Now, whether or not Chuck Grassley, the Judiciary Chairman, says, I'm going to stick with Monday, and if you're not going to do Monday, forget it.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this is written in a way to put him in a position that he can't really say that he has to negotiate back with her. If he just sticks to his deadline, it's going to make him look bad, and this
yep.
is the strategy, it seems
right.
to me.
Ron, what is your read on this, and what do you think is happening up on Capitol Hill behind the scenes?
Well, I agree with Donna. It really puts it really back in Chairman Grassley's court. I mean, Dr. Ford is saying she's prepared to testify. She's even prepared to testify next week. So it takes the idea of indefinite delay off the table mm-hmm. and puts a concrete timeline on it. She's backing off her request that the FBI do it first. She still thinks that's the best thing. I think all the experts think it's the best thing. But she says, I'm willing to testify even if that isn't met. All she's really looking for is a fair hearing and her personal safety. I think those are going to be hard things for Chairman Grassley to say no to. And if they try to jam and say, look, it's Monday or the highway, mm-hmm. I think they're going to take a big hit on this. If Brett Kavanaugh is confirmed, he's going to be serving on the Supreme Court until 2050. The idea that you'd wait a couple days to hold this hearing, that seems like a very reasonable request on Dr. Ford's part.
What about the notion, let's play this out as though she will be testifying mm-hmm. next week? Yeah. And my question is, we heard this from Senator Susan Collins earlier in the week saying, hey, let's have lawyers do the questioning mm-hmm. and the cross-examining. I've heard other lawyers say to me, you know, have lawyers who are sensitive to
Ron Klain says
harassment.
That.
Yeah.
Ron Klain, that is why we're talking to you. That's why
yeah,
I'm coming
thank
to you.
Appreciate
you know,
that.
Ron Klain says that. And I'm wondering, you know, because I know that's not unprecedented, do you think that that could be feasible here?
Well, I think it's not only feasible, I think it's advisable. Look, it's happened before in other kinds of hearings. During the Watergate hearings, this happened. During the Iran-Contra hearings, this happened. It did not happen during the Clarence Thomas, Anita Hill hearings, and it was a mistake that it didn't happen. Senators, some senators are good questioners, some aren't. That's not really the point. The point is you really need questioners who are not looking to score political points, but are looking to get to the truth, who understand yeah. how sexual assault cases are built, who understand how to deal with witnesses in this kind of sensitive matter. And having just one Republican lawyer, one Democratic lawyer ask the questions is the best way to have a professional, organized, fact-finding hearing and not a political sideshow.
Go ahead, Dana.
I find it hard to imagine, though, that the senators won't at least want to ask some questions following that, which is exactly, as you mentioned, Brooke, what Senator Susan Collins suggested. Have mm-hmm. a lawyer on each side representing each side of the story mm-hmm. start, but then finish with the senators. It's hard for me to imagine, and Ron not only has seen this movie before, he's lived this movie before. Yeah. So I defer to you, Ron, but knowing senators the way you do, just saying, you know what, we're just going to say, the floor is yours, lawyers, and not do their job
no, look,
in asking questions? What do you think?
Dan, I agree. At some point in time, the senators have a role to play, but it'd be great if the bulk of the questioning were done by not just lawyers, but people who are really experts in this kind of matter, people who understand how to deal with a witness who's been through what Dr. Ford says she's been through, and how to do it in a professional and reasonable manner. I mean, mm-hmm. in 1991, the senators did it, And look, I mean, I worked for the committee, but I have to say it was kind of a fiasco. It was one of the all-time great SNL sketches was the one parodying the senators questioning Clarence Thomas and Anita Hill. You cannot have a repeat of that, although potentially we will. And that's a tragedy if that happens.
What about the notion of having, you know, she's wanted this outside investigation, this FBI investigation. She's also wanted to have other witnesses testify,
yeah.
Ron. Is that advisable?
It's not only advisable, it seems to me absolutely essential. Well, they should agree to it, Brooke, because look, during the Thomas Hill hearings, 22 witnesses testified, not just Thomas and Hill, but 20 other witnesses who had information about the two of them and their backgrounds and their experiences together, times they saw them. And here we know there's at least one other person in this room when this assault allegedly happened. There are other people both Kavanaugh and Ford may have talked to. If you don't hear from the witnesses, you aren't having a hearing. If you aren't hearing from the people who have information, you're not seeking the truth. So the idea of excluding people with relevant information seems more like a railroad than a hearing to me.
The other piece of this, as I mentioned, this outside investigation, right? This is what Professor Ford has wanted, Dana. And we were looking back from the Anita Hill days, from 91, mm-hmm. then Senator Grassley, who's now obviously the chairman of the committee, he said this at the time. Roll it.
A rule like this should ensure once and for all that even an 11th hour charge like yours has been fully considered.
Fast forward to today.
Yeah.
Mighty similar.
Yes.
Why is it different this time?
Well, the moment, there are a lot of reasons, but the moment is different. We are in the Me Too era, and having a male panel, having male or female panel, frankly, either ignore somebody who is saying that she wants to come forward and talk, or to do it in a way that even remotely looks like, as Ron says, a railroad, is a lot more dicey. And what is interesting is that back then, he was a more junior, a junior Republican, but it was still a Republican nominee. Democrats ran the committee, but it was a Republican nominee. It's also a reminder of how different the atmosphere is. It is so ridiculously partisan now. Grassley, who's now the chairman, didn't even want to delay the vote, which was supposed to happen today, but was forced to do that because of Republicans like Susan Collins, like Lisa Murkowski, even Lindsey Graham and others saying, no, we have to at least wait and see if she wants to come forward. So the times are different in terms of women, but also, unfortunately, in terms of partisanship.
And lastly, you know, Ron, you brought up that SNL sketch, right? And we were, Anita Hill wrote that op-ed this week, and she, you know, closed by talking about the phrase, they just don't get it, right? Alluding to all the men up on that committee and dealing with her questioning and the sexual, the allegations of sexual harassment. I'm curious, in 2018, do you think they get it now?
Well, I hope they do. I hope they would. Look, one thing that has changed since 1991, in 1991, the Judiciary Committee was all male. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one difference this time is that while unfortunately on the Republican side, they're still all male, of the 10 Democrats, three are women. And the senior Democrat on that committee, Dianne Feinstein, was elected for the first time in 1992 as a reaction to what happened to Anita Hill. So kind of history's coming full circle here with Dianne Feinstein, one of those winners in that so-called Year of the Women, now the most senior Democrat on the Judiciary Committee.
28 women the year later, the Year of the Woman in 92, right, who would really run citing their frustration over what had happened with Anita Hill. My, oh, my, when we wake up November 7th with all the women on the ballot, I will be curious to see what happens. Ron Klain, Dana Bash, thank you both.